Yeah, you take it away.
I got all your messages this morning. Yeah, I didn't have my phone yesterday.
Hi all, thanks a lot for coming today. So this is Conscious Isolation in collaboration with the University of East London. And we have had the great privilege today to introduce Richard Wilson. Now Richard's an internationally critically acclaimed sculptor and installation artist that has given the world wonderful and thought-provoking public artworks such as Slice of Reality, which is in the Greenwich Peninsula, 2050, Slipstream, which is Terminal 2 of Heathrow, I believe,
right.
As well as Water Table and Red Hot, just to name a few. Richard plays with and transforms space and is celebrated for his architectural interventions, which are inspired from his interests in engineering and construction. Richard has exhibited nationally and internationally for over 40 years, and he was nominated for the Turner Prize on two different occasions, and also was awarded the prestigious DAAD residency in Berlin. I'd like to now hand over to you, Richard. Thank you ever so much for coming in and giving this talk for us today.
Hello. Thank you very much, Sam. It's nice to be with a real group of people as opposed to lockdown. I've chosen about 60 images, which I'll go through quite quickly because I think we've only got an hour. But I've orientated it in choosing works that have some relationship to architecture, architectural space, or a tampering with architecture. So there are one or two objects in here, but the big object stuff I haven't brought along, and works that don't deal with that theme I've also ignored. So we have an architectural theme running through these. But predominantly, I play around with space. We all walk in and exist in space, but it's very, very difficult to describe what space is. I mean, if you think about what a cave is, you need the mountain to know what a cave is. Otherwise, if you took the mountain away, there's no cave. It's about the void, it's about a space. And it's very difficult to describe that. All you can do is you can have examples, and I'll give you two examples which I've always thought about and passed on to other people. The Japanese director of a famous phone company wanted to reduce the size of his phone, his mobile phone, and he had his team working for a year, and they brought in products. And each time they brought one in, he would drop it in a glass of water, and if a bubble came out, he said there's still space in there. And I think that's a really lovely story about a little bit of space and what it creates if you drop it in water. The other one is, I thought it was a joke when someone told me this a couple of years ago, but it's just drawing an analogy to space, really. It's not really describing it, but a young man moved into a lockup on a site, an industrial site, and that afternoon he collected enough rubbish to put into a skip, and he noticed the site next door, the unit next door, had a skip outside, and someone was throwing a few bits in there. And he went over to the guy and said, "Do you mind if I put some of my rubbish in there and I'll pay you part of the skip cost?" And the guy said, "It's absolutely okay. I'm sure my boss won't worry about it. Do it in the morning." So in the morning, he got in early and started chucking his rubbish in the skip. And the boss pulled up in his car and jumped out and said, "Hey, what do you think you're doing?" And he said, "It's all right, I'm chucking my rubbish away, but your friend or your colleague gave me permission." And he said, "Well, that's all right, otherwise I would have done you for stealing." And he said, "No, I'm not taking anything out the skip, I'm chucking stuff in." And he said, "Exactly, you're stealing my space." First piece of work I'm going to describe is probably the party piece of my career. It came sort of about 10 years after leaving a postgraduate course at Reading University. This is 1987. I left in 1976. 1987, What you're looking at is a room filled with hazardous waste material. You'd be arrested for pouring a gallon of that down a drain and you'll be prosecuted. But here, you've got 600 gallons of a pollutant which people spoke about in terms of beauty. So what one's trying to do here is not just build the TARDIS piece in my career, which was to be able to do something to that room, that physical space of architecture, to double it in some kind of way. And the way that's done is through reflection. A tank is built, the oil is poured in, and a corridor is built from the entrance to the gallery space into the space. So you become the object amongst the reflection. So here is the edge of the tank. And as you can see, the reflection of the window and the reflection of up in the ceiling. And it's a completely psychological experience. People, it's a conundrum, it's a visual conundrum. There's a delay between what happens here and what happens up in here. And it causes people to panic because of the experience of vertigo. And so they grab the sides, there's oil everywhere. There are mishaps with it. It's not site specific. It's been 13 times, it's been built 13 times in different venues around the world. And it's actually the same ingredients, it's just the focus changes on each occasion. So in this instance, this was 1991, Saatchi Gallery Boundary Road. And then it went to Japan, that's Mito Art Tower. This is County Hall, again Saatchi. So this line along here, all of this is reflection. This is the corridor that you walk into. And it's just doubling the space through the illusion of reflection. I think if you're going to make something about transformation, you might as well try and use a material that's been through its own transformation. I mean, this substance is millions of years old, basically. And what it does to the environment is excruciating, but at the same time, what it does to these environments is absolutely mesmerizing. So it's a very, very popular piece. I've just finished building this in Istanbul in a gallery. I thought I'd just put this in. This was the first maquette I made for that piece of work. You could also say this is a waste material. I was in the Algarve at the time trying to dream up an idea for the Max Gallery, 1987, we opened that piece of work. So I was in the Algarve in 1986 on a long summer holiday, and one Sunday, pondering on that idea, I suddenly started to get towards the notion of flooding the space with a reflective material. And I needed to visualize that. Everything I do, I draw, and then I make a model, because once I've got the model, I can see what I'm doing with it. So I cycled into the local village and found a shoebox in a dustbin, and I had some glue, and I just cut the shoebox up and made that maquette. So it's a piece of rubbish, but it's been transformed with my hands in the same way as the oil has been transformed. And it's a precious item now. I still have that maquette. This is the same gallery. This is now 1989. It's very difficult to go back to the same space of doing the oil and trying to conjure a new idea. But what I started to fathom and recognize about the architecture was that the room wasn't really tampered with 2050. It was adjusted through a visual conundrum of reflection. But in this 1989 return, I decided to invert the whole concept and actually shrink the internal space of architecture and let the space of the world, let's say, flood into the room. So by disengaging 22 feet by 7 feet of the crystal clear window and bringing it into the room and then boxing it back to the outside world, the architectural space was drastically reduced. It was quite cramped in there when you had the private view. And this is levitated, it's supported on the ceiling, but the method of cladding the boxing back to the outside world is really following the sort of logic of windows, which is sort of many panels inserted into a framework and a kind of puckered plastic material that you'd find on international lorries, on the trailers. So it's a puckering like curtains, and it's a kind of a glazing, which is really mimicking the softboard artificial or false ceiling of the gallery itself. So I was using visual information from the space. And as you can see, this work is particular to something I was playing around with at that time in my career, which was to actually take elements of architecture that existed in a space or at the boundary of a space and actually incorporate them in the work. You enlist them into the work. That makes them very difficult to sell. In fact, this piece did sell, but not with that window. It sold as a concept. So in a sense, this is a site-specific piece, but not site-dependable. It can be built elsewhere, if I agree. This leads on to, I've forgotten what the period is now, 1991. It was a brand new build up in Stockton. They wanted a sculpture either on the roof of the new build or somewhere within the building. They weren't really sure what they wanted, but I came up with the idea of just building them a bearing. I worked with engineers, Price and Myers, who are based in London, and I've worked with them up until, you know, recently, still am at. And what we decided to do was actually make part of the building the sculpture. So what you have is an oscillation taking place. This large 8-meter bearing was built. It was inserted whilst the building was being assembled. And you can see the brisolet, you can see the skimmed wall section, and you can see the glaze section moves 300 degrees only backwards and forwards. So the opaque becomes transparent, the transparent becomes opaque. And it was a new art center. It still is still an art center. And in some ways, it was trying to announce as a flag waving that it was a live performance space. I mean, it had a theater, a cinema, a live stage, performance stage, two bars, and a gymnasium, but no gallery. So that just gives you an idea, going round and down, full extreme. So as you came down the stairs, you could see out and you could look in. It moved about the speed of the second hand of a clock. So just enough. If you're passing in a car, you probably wouldn't see it moving unless you stopped. And that led on to another idea a little bit later on. This wasn't realized until 2000, I forgot when the period was actually, I'm losing dates. But these were a series of maquettes I've been making over 9 years trying to make this piece of work. And it was one of those peculiar situations where I found people who would want to invest in it, but we couldn't find a building, or vice versa. There were times when I found a building, but there was no one available with the money. But there was a coincidence when Liverpool became European Capital of Culture, and I think that was in 2009. And I met socially the head of the Liverpool Biennale, Lewis Biggs. I met him in London at a private view, and I was in a pub with him after the private view. And I started to discuss with him a possibility if he was interested. And he said to me, after listening to me, "I'll get back to you within a week." By the time I got home that evening, he'd left me a message saying, "You must come up now," straight away. So I went up and I made a series of models to first instruct myself. It's a bit like doing mental gymnastics. If you play around with these things and look at them, you can get a very clear idea as to what it is you want to do, even though it may not be the final tuned piece of work. But I incorporated those maquettes with these earlier maquettes and went up and spoke to engineers, explained the idea to them, showed them the maquettes, that worked. We also took the maquettes to funders, so that was a way of making a reason for maquettes to be important in the practice. And of course, for clarification of myself, as I was saying earlier on, you know, I make a lot of models just to see if the thing will stand up in my world. And I was shown five buildings, and we identified this building as possibly being the one that could work for the sculpture. And the idea was to take the forlorn and the written off and the eyesore and the thing that needs to be gotten rid of in the city and somehow through the power of sculpture, transform it. So you would get people coming from around the world to come and see this. And it was so popular, it was programmed for a year, but it ran until 2012 when it was finally turned off because the licensing of the building had to be handed back. It was due for demolition. In fact, it's still there today and can be switched back on, but it depends. It's owned by the local authority. They sold it to a private entrepreneur. If he was to ever switch it on, he would have to carry the warranty of that, which means basically if a piece of glass fell out and hit somebody, he would be responsible. So it's sitting there dormant. The building is unused. But basically what happens is, like the previous piece, this turns, but it turns 360 degrees. It's spinning, and it's spinning much faster. I mean, all buildings are vibrating. There are computer programs that will tell you that this building is currently rocking like this because we're doing, what, 67,000 miles an hour spinning on the globe. And we often think about architecture as a static object, you know, as static objects, but they're not. Our whole skyline is constantly being re-examined and reanimated. Things are pulled down and things go back up. So architecture is a slow or fast moving event, if you think about it in that way. So Yates's Wine Lodge, and what was interesting is that the private view, an old boy came up to me and he said, a lot of us staggered out of there, mate, and saw that moving before you did it. And just to give you an idea exactly what happens here, I've just got a short film that will... That should... Eight and a half meters across. So that's the whole of the facade actually turning on a spindle. It came through a happy accident whilst modeling 9 years previously, the bit for Over Easy, where I had a disc and I glued a spindle, and overnight it fell over about 50 degrees. And in the morning I twisted it and it created that. Again, it's not a site-specific piece or site-dependable. That could go anywhere. I mean, I've had invitations to build this again. It just wasn't an ideal building in that situation. But I mean, this was perfect in that if you're doing something with bricks, it's a far more difficult process. So you'll see that come back on itself, and then we'll go to the next. Title of that piece is Turning the Place Over. And you can see what's happening. It's this oscillation inside and outside. The exterior becomes part of the interior and vice versa. So this is now Niigata Prefecture in Japan, west coast of Japan, 2000. And this is the landscape. It was a region, the Niigata Prefecture, that was dying. Severe winters, 6 foot snow drifts most winters. The youth were all going to the cities, and the government at the time became concerned at the loss of the region and it falling into, going into decline. And so a 10-year program was put together involving or including also artists. And in the first year, they invited 30 artists from around the world to come and make permanent works in Niigata Prefecture, which is a vast area of the west coast of Japan, and to place these works in the landscape with the one proviso, it had to be a relationship. It was the artist having a relationship with the site. And of course, I'd been working quite a bit up until then in the, let's say, the interior spaces, in architectural spaces and tampering with architecture. And I was flying back trying to think about an idea, and it was one of those peculiar moments where you get an idea in 5 minutes. I was looking at the curvature of the world, and I was thinking, what can I do? I play with architecture. I've just been to a rural environment. It doesn't really work for me. I'm inexperienced in that domain, really. But then I started to think, well, if I'm playing with architecture, why don't I take my house and put it in Japan? Just make it as a linear drawing. But not just to place it in Japan, but to work with the engineers and measure my house in Southwark, what its relationship to horizontal and vertical in Southwark, in London, off the North Star. You measure five angles of collimation, so you've got five mathematical equations. You take them round to Japan, and you set them up again. So my house sits in Japan, but that's the horizontal of Japan. If you turn that round, it means the house is completely upside down because it's standing at the exact angles it stands in London. So you've got this thing of like the house has just been pushed straight through and it's ended up as a linear drawing. Oh, I'm going the wrong way. This is just going forward when I press to go back. Let's just take that back to... Oh, hang on, sorry. Yeah, so what you've got here is you've got the roof and you've got the back extension, and this is the base of the house on here. And of course, you've got the verticals and horizontals of the gateway, the temple gateway, to the temple just up the road. And that's one more angle. And you can see the mezzanine stuck into the ground and the back supported there as well. So it's really about playing around with the angles of a structure on a sphere. Obviously, when you go to certain spaces, there are restrictions. You're not allowed to tamper with the architecture. And of course, one doesn't want to give oneself the name of being a sort of kamikaze expert on architecture. I mean, these things aren't violations. They're careful tamperings or sensitive tamperings. And when that is impossible to do, one takes one's own architecture along. So in this instance, this was a show in the Museum of Contemporary Art in Oslo many years ago, where I took a typical British idea of the Scandinavian chalet and dissected from that chalet, that architectural structure, a great deal of its interior and implanted a copy of the gallery. So this is the wall of the gallery with its vents and its floor. And the interior is much greater than the architecture that it's taken over. And of course, you could walk up on that floor. It actually runs and matches in along here. So people would walk along and walk up here and back out. And there were two doorways. So the architecture and the interior completely taken over the space. So one had to squeeze around the whole structure. And then there are obvious things where to do with architecture as skin. I mean, we look at many buildings now in the city, and they all seem to be about skins rather than function. I mean, you've got all your gherkins and your walkie-talkies, etc. And this was just like a kind of an undoing and a twisting of a space, an upsetting of that space in some kind of way. And that led on to, more recently, a series of sculptures which I made for the Annely Juda Gallery. And this is one example where I was taking slices from spaces. Like, if you imagine cutting right through here, as a slice all the way around and making what that space would be, making that space solid. I suppose if you think sort of White Reed, Rachel White Reed's castings of complete rooms, like the house or the room, it's kind of got that thing about trying to build space. And so these drawings were activated. And this was a space at home between a door and a curtain in front of another doorway. I just put two laser beams through, marked the whole thing up, measured everything off. I mean, the other way of doing this is I've done it with scanning, where you can go into a building and just take a complete scan, rotate the camera and pull away that space and then make that space solid in some way. And this was that space compressed. So it's stealing space compressed. And so if you go just back one, you'll see that there's the curtain, there's the handrail coming down, and there's the door. So all those details were kind of shrunken, let's say. And so you've got the door here, you've got a picture on the wall, you've got a part of the ceiling cutting through there, and that's the handrail. You could push that in on the staircase. So it's a kind of a skin trying to describe a slice of space. And that followed on to taking a scan off the exterior of the street in which the Annely Juda Gallery is located. And then, rather like making a cube out of paper, I was starting to cut the photographs up so I could fold that up into a cube, into a box. And then it was a case of just copying all of these details of the street to make up in wood, the brickwork, etc. So it's like six facets, top, bottom, and four sides of a cube that come together, which is a folded up section of the facade. So it's taking the plane and creating volume in architecture. So this is the doorway on its side, as you can see. And leading on lots of models and playing around with the idea again, with harking back to say the oil, if you just take one section of a bought model and you reproduce it eight times, so you've got the original bit and then you invert it and you invert it and you flick it back and you do the same with the back, you've got a completeness of one building, which is an impossibility to actually assemble, but is about a repetition of eight moments of a quarter of a building. So you can see, you know, it's a raceway. It's from an old model of the Nuremberg start-stop building. It's called start-stop building. Because one doesn't really know where it starts and stops. You can see this with the wording being flipped, it's all back to front and it comes down, it's upside down. And it happens on the other side. And then there's situations where you get offered a piazza with this new build. And that new build is all about a set of regulations, a set of learnt principles and orders of architecture. And how can you challenge that in some way to make that more obvious or evident? The way you can do that is look at that bricoleur architecture that you find on allotment structures or on allotments, where people will take a window and use that to make a roof, and they'll take a door to make that a wall. And they'll take a polythene bag to make the door. So all the rules of the bricoleur at the allotment are being not broken, but they're being translated in another way, and they do work. And so this was based on a series of drawings taken, funny enough, from the big allotment that's up on the motorway roundabout, the one at Barking up there, and a series of photographs, and then assembling in wood the structures to be a set of stories or a set of floors in the same way as this set of rules produces this. That was cast in aluminium. This was another commission. It's down in Holborn. It's very much a chameleon piece of work. You only see it if you're told where it is. And it's quite strange because it's a very big piece. It's 18 meters tall. It's only when you look up, you go, oh, there it is. I remember listening to a radio program about it where someone said they'd passed the place for years and never seen it. Now they've spotted it. They wanted to know what it was all about. So it appeared on a radio program. This is Sardinia Street, and this is, I think it's High Holborn. Is it High Holborn? Holborn Street, running up to Holborn, from Aldwych down here. And this is the chamfered corner to the building, and they were after a small sculpture to be placed on that corner. And I was invited to submit a proposal, which was rather ambitious, but again was a tampering with that skin along that street. What we did is we copied a section, a metre and a half section on the Sardinia side and a metre and a half section on the Holborn side, and we put them together to lose the chamfered edge or the chamfered corner and to create an actual 90 degree corner. So this drawing again gives you an idea what was being copied and the two pieces coming together to produce that section that would then be produced in jesmonite, which is a kind of a cement, a plastic cement, with powdered Portland stone placed into that, so that you could marry together the what would be apparent, you could marry together the materials, because that's all Portland stone there. And then this section here, this won the competition. The architectural principles make no sense whatsoever. You've got two windows colliding there. You don't build like that. So the function of architecture was ignored, and I was just playing with the appearance, the surface of the architecture, the skin, and putting the two skins together. We didn't have permission to touch down on the pavement here. It was a pedestrian way, we weren't allowed to touch it. So when we built the mold in the factory, we put a forklift truck and pushed it up, and then there was some manipulation of what we pushed, and then the whole thing was cast in two or three sections and then pinned to the surface. So as you walk along, you don't really look up, that you've got all this bit and then the rest running up to the cornice work at the top, with this slight gap just telling you that this is a plug-on, it's an addition, it's a falsification. Kingsway, that's what it's on, not Holborn, Kingsway. And you can see that sort of marriage of the material work really beautifully. Hang on a minute, lads, I've got a great idea. 2012, it was a commission in relation to the Olympics, the UK Olympics. They were looking for a cultural aspect to place sculptures in the regions to act as part of the announcement. And the Dulawar Pavilion was the one I secured as a location. It was an invite from the late director there, Alan Hayden, to do a rooftop piece. And Anthony Gormley had been the previous recipient of that, not award, but that opportunity. And he worked on this landscaped terrace here. And so I knew I didn't want to touch that part of the building, that I would look elsewhere, and came up with the idea of using this back area and looking very much at having something cantilevered, rather like this window is cantilevered off. I mean, this is a Mendelssohn piece of architecture, a very beautiful piece of architecture. I need something to draw one's attention just to the edges of the building, the corners of the building, not the planes of the building. How can I do that? A bit like that fabulous Italian Job film where the coach is on the precipice or the edge of a cliff. Something like that to draw your attention to the building. It's an iconic building. Why don't I use something that's just as iconic? And suddenly it clicked that maybe one just puts a coach there, like the coach in the film, and have it oscillating so that you can see what happens. Everyone just comes down and takes photographs because they've suddenly been caught in that dazzle of the sculpture. But what I liked about it was that the Union Jack flew off this staff here. We took that down, and the red, white, and blue coach from that film became the Union Jack. It became the flag flying piece for the Olympics. And as you know, those guys in there were after gold, and our Olympia athletes were after gold as well. So it was all kind of making sense as a story. Hydraulically teetering, rather like the end of the pier ride that you'd have at one of these kind of sort of declining, dare I say that, declining resorts. But again, inspired initially by the flagpole and this cantilevering, it was taking information from the site and then seeing how that can feed the idea. And of course, that again, we've got the coach still. It can go anywhere. This is the Peninsula Hotel in Hong Kong. They wanted it the other year, so we sent a coach out to Hong Kong. Of course, it great publicity. You know, everyone was taking selfies with that behind them, and that went round the world. More recently, not so high up, but we did this in Turin for the art fair, and it was the 50th anniversary of the film. So they said, could they borrow the piece of work? And I slightly adapted it, because this is a building site. This is a new build going in, has gone in now. And we got a wrap made, which was a cliff-like wrap. So it kind of worked very much in terms of trying to mimic more of the film, you know, the things on the edge or the precipice of a cliff. And so one was taking that plane and just playing it off against the colors of the coach. Talking about resorts in decline, Folkestone, this is about 2011, 2012, maybe a bit more, I don't know. A number of artists were invited down to think about making works in this rather forlorn environment. And I came across this crazy golf course at the back of the Esplanade. Very, very brutalized, because the vandals had got in, pulled up all the material. You can see it could never be renovated. It was cracking and falling apart. And I asked if I could take that, not as a site, but as material, to say something about what was happening with Folkestone. I mean, Folkestone was in decline, and an individual came forward, a very wealthy individual, Roger de Haan, and he's put a lot of money into revitalizing, rather like the Niigataa prefecture piece, an individual trying to revitalize, along with the local authorities, something of Folkestone to make it a kind of a cultural center. So they have this triennial, and artists are invited from all over the world to come and make pieces of work. So I was trying to say something about that transformation period. This was the first of the first exhibition of the triennial, and I think there must have been about 15 artists there altogether. And we all had a site that we chose, and I chose mine down by the seafront, where there were a lot of beach huts. Because the idea was to actually cut 18 sections from that 18-hole crazy golf course. And those 18 sections make up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15... 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 18 holes, which is the title of the piece of work, which is gables, sides, and roof. And one just went to the game, the crazy golf course, and just cut from the golf course those sections and had them regrassed and repainted and mounted on this plinth. And they became three beach huts that sort of talk and represent a past and a future. From Folkestone, this was Folkestone, people remember playing on that crazy golf course, but this is predicting a future, a new build, an arising, let's say. So you can see each piece had like the hole, there's a hole up there, and then there's like details. This is the water, you know, when the ball goes. And there's a little sort of thing where you bat the ball up and it rolls around and back down to the hole. So those kind of details were kept. Piece is still there today. And you can see they're sitting with another type of architecture, but they're all trying to be the same. That's the Arco Trent, year 2000 again, the Millennium Dome. They were looking for 9 artists to come up with works of art on that peninsula site to surround the part of the dome out on that North Meadow Park that was there at that time. There's now a hotel. And working with or playing with architecture, I was beginning to think about maritime architecture and chose to take a scrapped ship that was purchased very, very cheaply. And I did an exchange with a breaker and gave him the ship, or gave the company the ship, in exchange for this slice, which they reinforced. And this was placed down on the river. It was actually intended to be where the zero longitude cuts Greenwich. There's a lovely strip of brass up in Greenwich Park, and people stand with their legs between it, and they're between 0 degrees. And this was, if you can slice a district with a time zone, put a slice of something on that time zone to indicate that line, that zero time. But it was also, by cutting it like that, it was a bit like the dome itself. I mean, the dome is a tent. It's a parcel of space. It's a skin, rather like an inverted umbrella. It's held up and pulled up on tension lines. And it's just a big parcel of space, which you can see once you do that to a ship. You can see all these little parcels in there. But the other thing is, you know, it's all about the millennium. It's all about coming to this moment in the millennium, a point in that time. And I was beginning to think very much about the soundbite in an interview or in film, where a soundbite is like just a moment of something much greater. And that seemed to be what that midnight hour seemed to be. So this is a moment of something much greater. What can I put in there as a sort of an architectural, maritime architectural form that can talk about something that's much bigger than itself? But it's also, indirectly, it's also a doff of the cap to the lost merchant seamen of the river. I mean, in 1936, at the coronation of King George, there were 1,000 ships going in and out of that river, Thames, at that point, just up from where you are here. And now you'll probably see one a week, and it won't be a big ship. All that industry and all our moving in and out to our Commonwealth has gone. So this was a kind of a doffing of the cap and almost a lament for it to rust back into the river. But in actual fact, at the end of the exhibition, after a year, as payment, I should say, we were all handed back our work. And of course, it was difficult to know what to do with it. So I went and saw the Port of London Authority and had permission to keep it there. I bought a license, and it's still there today, albeit it needs a little bit of attention, but it's just finished housing one part of Jem Finer's exhibition, which was Sonic Ray, where a laser line was shot right through the glass into the space, and that beam of light was carrying sound from Trinity Boy Wharf, his 1,000-year piece, and it was projected across to the slice. But after that 1 year, I took it over and converted it and made an office and a model making space. And I worked there for about 5 years with a team. We were just making bits and pieces. But in the end, it just proved to be a little bit too harsh for my helpers. I could do it. So it's empty and sort of surplus to requirement, but gives you an idea of the spaces that are there. In an ideal world, one would raise it and obtain all this, because the tide, when it's in, actually sits at where its plimsoll line would be as a ship. So it's a form, it's a structure in the river, harking back to all that moment of 2000. And last project. This came to fruition in 2014, but we started in 2011. And this is the new, I say new, 2021. It opened in 2014, May of 2014. This is the new Terminal 2 at Heathrow Airport, the Queen Elizabeth Terminal. And what you're looking at here is the construction site of that terminal. And this allocated area here is a space between the terminal itself and the services, the transport services of getting people to the buses and the underground. So this is now all filled in with lifts and everything else to take you up to various floors. There's some bridges across here. But what it left was this line of columns in the space to be used for a sculpture. Now there's 11 columns here. And one of the questions people ask me is, why is the work so big? Well, size of work is all relative to the space you're given. And that's not to say you can't make a thimble-sized piece of work for this space here. If it's good, it'll work. But certain spaces need grandiose scale. But the notion of big is interesting because I chose to use 4 of the 11 columns to place a sculpture, which was 76 meters long and 74 tons. And what it is, it's come from this sketch, which is the line of columns run all the way along here, but I chose to work with 4 columns within the bridge. And the idea of a movement in space, I mean, we're all taking a journey, we're all arriving, or we're all just getting off a distance that we've just traveled. And in that, I wanted to somehow talk about that and make a journey for the eye. So as you walk along this piece, rather like a drill bit, this thing should undulate and move. And I wanted to take an object to do that. If I can take this and throw it across the room, it's going to make a shape as it cuts through air. I mean, the easiest way of describing that is if I drop that through clay and it went through, I threw it through clay and it twisted around. And then I filled that hole it made with plaster. I'd have a very intriguing form. So this was something I was trying to work out. And also what object to use. And finally decided to use a small aircraft, not necessarily a light aircraft, but I went along and saw the 3-time world champion Paul Bonham, the ace pilot for the Red Bull air races. And we looked at his plane and copied his plane and produced a sculpture, which this was pre that, but this gives you some idea of what I was attempting to try and get at to win the competition. So lots of drawings were made, et cetera, et cetera. The interview took place, there were several interviews. We finally, I say we, the team, finally secured the gig. And 1 year overcoming all the bureaucracy, 1 year doing all the engineering, and 1 year with all the fabrication and install. So it's a 3-year project, rather like a big architectural project in itself when building a building. Gives you some idea of the size of the piece of work. I think that's 8 1/4, 8 1/2 bus, you know, route masters, an A400 Air France, not as big as the sculpture. So it gives you some idea of what we are attempting to try and build as a fluid form in space. And how that form was finally modeled. I mean, I tried lots of things. The way I convinced them at the interview is I got a hamster ball, a clear hamster ball, and I put an aeroplane in it, a model aeroplane, and I just rolled it along the floor and it made that. I said, imagine that as a shape. That wasn't enough. So what we had to do in the end, once we got the gig, by the way, is that we were modeling on the computer. It was the only way to do it. But give you an idea how the shape comes about. So this is throwing something in the virtual world. It's not in the real world. So we've got this generic form of the small light aircraft. And that gives you all the information you need to build that piece of work. And these are the 23 sections, 21, I thought it was 23. Okay, all the sections that needed to be built at the factory to get them down here. And the size of those are all dictated by what you can get on the motorway. You know, if you could get an enormous lorry to do it, you could probably halve that. But there isn't such a thing in existence. You've got 44 foot low loaders. So you've got to make each section capable of getting out of Hull, where the piece was built, getting down the motorway and getting across the two airstrips, the takeoff strips, and into the site, into the terminal, to be able to be erected on site. So the engineers spent a year working out all of their diagrams and drawings, working out all the intricate details. First of all, an armature, they're bridge building. They're going from four columns. They're having to bridge between the three spaces of those four columns and the cantilevering to be able to then put a series of spars out to then take a series of bulkheads. So these are the initial internal structures that had to be built. This is what holds the sculpture together. It's like a necklace. This is one pearl of 21 or 23 pearls, and they bolt together on these planes here. Imagine that being turned on its side. That's it going forward. The best way of building this is to take each section and build it that way so you can get around with a ladder. If you turn it that way, you wouldn't be able to build it. It'd keep falling over. It's stable on a flat surface. So all sections were built vertically to be tipped horizontally. And then you can see the bulkheads went in, all drawn off and CNC cut from the virtual models that were being made by the engineers. And then these series of lattices and spars to take two layers of plywood. So you start to skin the piece up. Each piece is a bespoke section, all marked out, numbered and gridded so that one wouldn't make the mistake of using the wrong bit in the wrong place. And then those skins were then worked back with fillers, etc., and then skinned up with the final aluminium surface. So we've got 21 of these, and they're all in the factory ready to go. And then we had a two-hour window, 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock in the morning. So these left overnight from Hull. They left about 10:30 at night. They travelled overnight down the motorway, sometimes with a police escort out of Hull because of the nature of all the street furniture that could get damaged and all the traffic that could get in the way. So these were the big loaders that were sent. We had two of these loaders going backwards and forwards over a period of weeks, bringing these pieces down. And you can see the kind of scale of them. I mean, they were all designed to fit on their own trolleys so that legs would drop down, the lorry would drive away, the legs would wheel down, and then these would be craned off. So there was a whole logistics problem to be dealt with. And this is the beginning of where you see the spars bolting onto the columns, and then these added on. So there's this whole sequence of events building between the spars. And that's coming up to the nose, that very optimistic up and away sense that the piece of work has. And that gives you that sense of aerodynamic and velocity and speed in the form, which is something that one's all experiencing when you're in an aeroplane, although you're kind of cushioned from it. You know, you're traveling at 500 miles an hour, you're 500 feet up in the air. Is it 500 miles, 400 miles an hour? And so this sort of sense of velocity, I felt needed to be sort of, you needed to be informed before you got on the aeroplane. And that gives you a sense of the building site at the location. So the location became a kind of studio for 3 or 4 months where these pieces were then assembled. And it was very interesting because we had to train up a whole series of people, a whole load of climbers, you know, mountaineers, who were experts with rope, but not necessarily with the tools they had to use. And they were all dangling off this piece of work to do these infill sections on each column. And they were all trained in Hull. We had a 2-week training session where everyone was hanging from the roof of the factory, building stuff. And so the final piece, it's there today. And as I say, you know, 4 of the columns incorporated out of the 11, that's the size it is. It works between the departure and arrival bridges. This is arrivals down here. This is departures up here. And the piece is sectioned within that, and you've got this beautiful up and away feeling when you come up the escalator. So the piece is below or above you and then below you. So you've got that sort of animated movement with the piece of work as it scrolls in front of you. That's given you some idea of the detailing that we achieved with the aluminium skin on the form. Thank you and good night.
Thanks so much. Have we got time for questions?
Yeah, certainly.
I've had a couple from online, so we'll start with those and then move to the floor. So the first one online is, you're always taking risks and almost destroying the finish of the building. Do you get help with planning risks assessment for your work?
That's an interesting question, because there's always a hidden agenda. If it looks as if the building is being damaged, it's a bit like turning the place over. I knew, not everyone knew, but I knew that was going to be demolished or should have been demolished. Therefore, I know I can take liberties in doing something to that building, and it's not going to affect it afterwards because it'll be felled. So what I said earlier, sensitively choreographed, I think I try to be very careful about my tampering. So if I was doing something in here, it wouldn't be that I'd come in as the mad axeman and hack a hole in the wall or something like that. I'd have to be sensitive to the location. And it's only if one said, you know, we're going to expand all this, that wall's coming down later. So can you come up with an idea? That would then give me enough to think, well, I could be structurally daring here and tweak this and tweak that. But at the end of the day, they never saw the lady in half. It's a sleight of hand, and it's the same with the sculpture. You know, you do it, it looks structurally daring, it looks as if you've had a good go at something, but in fact, it's all replaceable. That window that came out at Matt's gallery was very, very carefully extracted. Everything was undone very, very carefully, all put away in boxes, photographs taken, the window was taken out, it was designed that way to go in, it came out, the structure was made, we made some burglar-proof defence on that extreme perimeter of the boundary of the wall so no one could get in at night. And after the run of, I think, 3 or 4 weeks for that exhibition, everything went back in and was repainted. So the tampering is very sensitively choreographed. Does that answer?
Yeah, I think so. And from another person online that follows on from that, are you ever worried about serious accidents happening, a la Richard Serra, either during installation or when the sculpture is in place?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, I did do a lot of things where I don't think I could get away with them now. I think health and safety is really, you know, taken control of what you're not so much allowed to do, but the process and principles by which you do them. I mean, for things like this, we had to fill out all sorts of warranties and, you know, health and safety stuff, just to be able to convince certain people that it was going to work and that it was going to receive permission to go ahead. But of course, you do that with your friends. You know, you find good friends like engineers, Price and Myers structural engineers, AKT2 engineers. I work with a lot of big companies and they have enormous experience with that side of things. And it's very easy, as I say, it's very easy to make things look structurally daring, but in fact, they're way, way overspecced by the engineers. So the amount of strengthening we had to put in the structure for the piece at Heathrow has to withstand a 90 mile per hour wind in that space. And I said to the engineers, why are we designing for something that will never happen? And they said to me, you don't know that in 20 years time. You have to design for 20 years time. So you think, yeah, maybe in 20 years time, there might be a sudden gust of wind at 90 mile an hour. So they're designing way beyond what one is expecting.
Thanks very much. Do we have any questions from the audience here? Yeah.
One of the pieces you showed towards the beginning at Matt's gallery, the window.
Yeah, window piece, yeah.
You mentioned that it was a difficult one to sell, but it did sell. Can you tell us where it went and how it was re-realized?
Yeah, it's an interesting one. I mean, the oil sold as well. You'd think, well, how do you do that? It's currently down in Tasmania with David Walsh, the Museum of Old and New. With that piece at Matt's gallery, I'm just trying to think of the collection. There was a collection, it was called the Weltkunst collection. It's now been disassembled and the pieces have all been moved on elsewhere. But at the time, a certain individual came forward with some money and said they wanted everything. They understood that they wouldn't get the window as an item, as a tangible thing, but they would have the right to ask me to make it somewhere if they ever found a site. But they also bought all the drawings, all the models. There was a late show film made of the piece of work. They've got a copy of that. They had all the negatives from all my documentation. So they bought a whole bulk of stuff that was based in Ireland. I think it was in Dublin for years. And it became a kind of resource center for students and people wanting to find out about these big projects. You know, you could go there and look through everything and get a really good sense of how a project like that can come to fruition through all these little bits, you know, from the early sketches through to the kind of technical stuff that I was doing, to all the drawings that were three-dimensional, that had sort of bits cut out the drawing sticking out of the wall so I could understand it. Then that collection was disbanded, about eight years ago, and it was all handed out free, and the Tate took it. So the Tate now have all the drawings and, you know, all the other bits, all the ancillary bits, but they don't have a window, you know. If they phone ever and say, you know, we've got this idea of a window for Liverpool or St. Ives, can you go and have a look at it? I'll go and have a look at it and see if it can be done. So I suppose what they've got is they've got the concept. Whereas with the oil, it's not a concept, it's owned, and I haven't made any more of them. There's only one, although I have my own, what's called artist copy. I'm never allowed to sell it, but I can go anywhere around the world to make that piece of work if I have the permission of the owner. And Saatchi bought it initially. He sold it to David Walsh in Tasmania. And both of those guys were, you know, very accommodating. They were always happy to have it travel because it's a good ad, you know, collection of. He got hold of it, didn't he? He kept it when they pulled the building down. Yeah.
So somebody's got that somewhere, but I think it does exist because
pissed. The building that piece was made in got pulled down sort of fairly recently, about 5-6 years ago.
Yeah, exactly.
And the director of the gallery, he'd moved off elsewhere, but he went back and he sourced that window and he's still got it. So he's a hoarder.
Too right. My question was, with turning the place over, when you look back at perhaps one of the other most impactful sculptors of the day, Gordon Matta-Clark, have you been compared to Conical Intersect a lot with that particular work?
Have I what?
You know Conical Intersect, this work that Gordon Matta-Clark cut out of the building beside the Pompidou Centre, which I think is a great piece of anti-architecture.
Yeah, I came across Gordon Matta-Clark about halfway through my career, interestingly, through Robin Klasnick. And very, very interesting artist. Unfortunately, died very young, too early, really. People have kind of paralleled me with him, and I think it's because we both have done tampered with architecture at some points in our careers. But I wouldn't say we were really on the same thing. He was far more political than I am in terms of what he was doing. He was making social comment about why our buildings left derelict and not used, and making that point about his immediate environment of New York. I was more of coming from a formalist point of view of sort of like that very first thing, you know, cutting, drilling and whatever it was. You know, we're not cheap, but we're slow. I was coming from the point of like having done the oscillating facade as a flag waving piece for that building. And then a happy accident of a spindle falling over. It's like, wow, I need a building just to see that thing oscillating. And then the kind of story was attached to it, because I realized by taking the written off, the ugly, the eyesore, and doing that, I can make people change their viewpoint on the building. And in a sense, that's a core to a lot of what I do, is really to try and challenge people's preconceptions of their world. And by doing that, I take things that you think you know, buildings, caravans, them in some way. So you go, oh my God, I didn't realize that was oil. You know, oh God, you know. How beautiful, as opposed to like, oh my God, smelly, horrible stuff.
One work you didn't show, I think, is the pool table sunk in the ground. Isn't
that yeah, right? I looked at that one and I thought it's not really about architecture, but you could say it was about location and it was about groundwork. I mean, this is a piece of work called Water Table. And basically, again, it was my last piece with Matt's gallery in Copperfield Road. And it was a full-size billiard table. I mean, the place had been the manufacturing site at one time for pool tables. And pre that, it was a manufacturing site for, I believe it was the plywood for fighter planes. And I acquired a full-size billiard table, but rather than having it standing in the gallery, this was the first show in the new gallery, I wanted people to come into the gallery and see the space and really understand the gallery space. And so I wanted the work to sit at the very periphery. And by that, I could have put it through the wall, outside, up in the ceiling. But I chose to dig down and locate the surface of that game with the surface of the floor. But the game has six holes by which you pop the balls. But in my sculpture, the table had acquired a seventh pocket in the form of a 28-inch diameter concrete Hepworth sewer pipe that went down 4 meters below ground to London's water table. And it's the reason for terrible rising damp. You know, when the rain comes off the Chilterns and the North South Downs, it runs into the London Valley, Clay Valley, floods the River Thames, but it also surfaces because we no longer have steam engines pulling all that water off in the factories. So the water rises and it's under us. You dig down here, you'll find water, especially because you're close to the river. And that's what happened. I dug down to that water, which I'd found accidentally through a previous idea there, and put a little mechanism down there, which was a couple of paddles under the water that just splashed the water every now and again. So you had the complete logic of this horizontal table and the logic of that game where you create all sorts of straight ricocheting points to bounce things off in mathematical ways. You had this other subjective thing, like this object or a fish or a crab or an eel down there, this murky depth amongst all this perfection. So yeah, it's got some architectural touches to it, but I thought I'd go over time.
Hi there. So you mentioned Anthony Gormley there, one of the pieces. So when Anthony started flooding gallery spaces with water, did you start thinking about casting yourself in steel?
No, yeah, we did that very recently at the Royal Academy, didn't he? Yeah, clever boy. Wonder where you got that idea. It's water. You can't, there's no case to say it's the same. I mean, you could say, well, there's a similar effect, but it doesn't bother me. I mean, people know the oil. Millions of people know the oil. I'm called the oil man around the world. They say it's the guy who did 2050. Oh, the oil man. It's kind of an interesting... It's an interesting title, really, to have. Because not a lot of artists get that kind of credit, that kind of title credit. You know, it's like, Anthony Gorman. Hi, Anthony Gorman. So I kind of like that. And I like the fact that it's a very popular piece. It's a very good calling card. And yeah, I don't hold the rights on oil. There's been other people playing around with oil, but I haven't. There was one guy filling rooms and then taking photographs and selling photographs, but you know, you just ignore it. Bastard. Hi, you made a lot of money.
Hey, I've got quick question. So I'm interested in the artistic ego or stubbornness to make your projects happen. Mainly, as someone said, not letting the health and safety police design your projects, or not letting planning permission or planning policy design your projects. Because I know, like in Holborn, I can imagine the planners having a field day with messing with the fabric of a building in a conservation area, or in Heathrow Airport, not letting terrorism, terrorism architecture, where I think that spine was to separate landside from airside, so vehicles couldn't kind of touch the airport.
What, the slipstream piece?
Yes.
Yeah, well, it's interesting. I mean, it was a bit hush-hush once upon a time, but those bearings on the sculpture took a hell of a lot of money, took a majority of the budget, because we hit a stumbling block about a third of the way in, where it was deemed a dangerous object should a bomb go off in an airport. And everything in an airport is designed for an explosion. It's very interesting the way everything's bolted down. You look at the size of windows. There are regulations about the design of these big public spaces. And somehow we'd gone under the loop, and it was suddenly discovered, and everything was halted. And we had to take a section up to Hadrian's Wall and have it blown up to see what would happen. And nothing happened because it was all tethered. And so they said, right, you've created another problem. If it doesn't fall apart and fly everywhere, the thump, the push from a bang, will laterally load the columns and buckle them and bring the roof down. What are you going to do about it? So the engineers spent 4 months designing laterally loaded bearings. By that, you clamp a bearing onto the column, which is going to hold the structure. But it also, if there's a bang, it goes sideways. Just takes the punch. It'll never happen. But it was a lot of money,
Because a lot of that is subjective. How much do you march into a room with your proposal and say, look, I don't care about planning policy or health and safety. This is the project and we're doing it this way.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. I mean, I'm a dreamer. I come up with ideas, but that's me. And that's the authorities and the money and the technical. And it's where they meet. And I like to meet somewhere up here. Sometimes I've had to meet down here, which means do you compromise or do you save the project by having to reconsider X, Y, Z issues to accommodate it? There's certain things that are much easier to get round than others. I mean, I'm always aware now of what the stipulations are. The one that really throws me is bureaucracy, though. I'm in one at the moment with the Middle East, and I haven't even got the gig, but what they're asking for is almost impossible to meet. So you do find there's situations where you have to question whether it's worth going any further. That's always sad. But the three things that affect work in that way you're talking would be bureaucracy, and there's ways around that, money, there's ways around that, and technical. I mean, with money, you don't want to throw too much because your profits go. Technical, you don't want to employ them for too long because your profits go. You don't want to over... It's a bit like the first idea before, I didn't show you water table, but the idea before that, we brought the engineers in, and that's when they found the water. And I realized I could have thrown a fortune at it and dammed the water, but it wasn't worth it technically, and it wasn't worth it financially. I might as well change the idea and work with the problem, which was the water. So suddenly the idea for the water table, the billiard table and the seventh pocket and the water down there all became a new piece of work. So it's really a question of being very, very flexible and just ducking and diving and seeing what you can get away with. It's getting a little bit more difficult. But the other thing is, I have to say, when you build up a bit of a reputation, it helps a lot, because you can pull in the right kind of engineers and everybody. And when you've got that gang with you, you know, it's very difficult for them to think that you don't know what you're doing. You know, you've assessed everything you can. And it's only when you get a left of center thing about laterally loaded bearings, that can be an issue. But otherwise, those are the three things that can stifle you, which are the three things that make the thing happen as well. And it's just where you meet, where you want to make your idea sit within that sort of gauge. often, actually, just going back on that, often when you really do hit a problem, you know, you can be a bit pissed off for a while, but then you think, actually, sometimes you can come up with a better idea, or just by adapting it. You know, it's a bit like there's, you know, there's loads of ideas you can get, but it's getting that particular idea, and then it's getting that idea to sit properly. It's very different to describe. It's like, you know, you've got an array of ideas, and you think, well, I'll start working around this idea. And then you think you've got it, but then if you really carry on tackling it, you start to find it. It's a bit like fine-tuning an idea. You can fine-tune it and get it absolutely right. And it's what architects have to do, because once they've got that, then the build starts. You can't say, oh, I think I want to move it 4 feet. Sorry, can we do that? Because ching, ching, the till's ringing. So you've got to, you know, in the same way with these big public projects, it was a very good learning curve for me, because, you know, I come from a background as a sculptor making objects. And it was only slowly that I started to work with site specificity. And then it was about, you know, getting involved in public art, which meant you had to have the idea pretty much sewn up to be able to sort of press the button, then everyone's just making. There's some little fine tuning you can do and catch before it's too late, but pretty much you've got to have the right idea.
We've got two more questions from the audience at home. The first one is, who is your favorite artist?
Who's my favorite artist? All got one? Oh, I don't know. My favorite. The thing is, it's not favorite artist. What I'd like to say is what my favorite works. And I've always thought, wouldn't it be great to put a show together of works that have moved me? It's a bit like I am with music. I mean, I like this sound, I like this sound, I like that sound. It's not like I like, you know, B.B. King or, you know, Chubby Checker or whatever it happens to be. So I would say I would prefer to answer something like, you know, my top 10 pieces. Whether I can think of them now, I don't know. But I mean, I would have a Bruce Nauman piece. I think he's okay if you want a name. He was a big influence on me. I think very much because of process, the way it's almost like he didn't worry if something looked ugly, so long as it held the concept, held the nourishment of his idea, and you could get excited. And also, I think because it wasn't so, they weren't so overmade. In the early days, I appreciated that the things didn't have to be precise. Unfortunately, today, one's challenged on that, because I can go and make stuff. My eyes are a bit dicky now, you know, I can still work on machinery, but if I sent it off somewhere to a factory, they make it beautifully. It's all done on computers, and I'm still, you know, I can't compete. So I do send a lot of stuff off. But no, I mean, works. I mean, Walter de Maria, lightning piece, fantastic work. And then the other spectrum, you know, I like a lot of Barry Flanagan's early stuff. Not the hair stuff, pre all of that. One or two unknown artists who were working in sound. There was a Japanese artist who made these enormous pieces where you needed 30 or 40 people in the gallery to all pick up ropes and pull like two logs, and they would just stridulate each other to make noise. So this was an instrument, but sculpture. So there's lots of things I've seen that entice me.
Great, thank you. And then from the same person, I guess the opposite question, if you could travel through time and destroy an artwork, which artwork would you destroy at the moment of conception?
Are we on film? I'd have to go far back, you know, to the dead. God, what would I destroy? I don't know, but I've seen some stuff recently. God, public art in France. You know, I mean, it's dire. It's absolutely dire. I can't think of one particular piece I'd like to destroy. I know it's a hypothetical question, but I think the idea of destroying someone else's works it's a bit like tearing up someone's book. You know, you can't do that stuff. It's too loaded. I could slag it off in a pub. That's as far as I'd go.
I guess it could also be any of yours. If there's any of mine.
This is interesting.
I guess.
I wouldn't use the word destroy. I've got all details on reconstruction, but a lot of my work doesn't exist. if I had to rebuild, if someone was interested in a piece of work, it'd be rebuilt. And it's because, one, I don't believe in the unique object, I suppose. And it's because of that, and because of very practical considerations like storage, you know, although I store the coach, you know, the till is ringing. And so I have to be very careful about exactly what I've got. And if I stored everything, I'd be bankrupt. So I have to go into a gallery and make a piece of work. And because those galleries have an ongoing program, the work has to come out and be dismantled. I'd use that word, not destroyed. It's dismantled and often put in the skip. And in a way, it makes that, it sometimes can give the effect of cheapening the work, in that it's just made for a moment and discarded. It's just, it's done through practicality. But I can rebuild everything I've made. I've got all the details, all the measurements, the methods, it's all logged. So, yeah, I mean, and I have done, when people have bought some of the objects, I've said, well, that one's not there anymore, but I've got this one, and we make it. And it's accepted.
Great, thank you. Any last ones from the floor here? Last questions?
Not. One I've always been asked, actually, it's a very interesting question. It's a common one, and most people say, when I give these talks, they say, what's your favourite space? Is it, you know, Museum of Contemporary Art, Los Angeles, or is it Saatchi Gallery, or Museum of Contemporary Art, Oslo? And they tend to be museums. And I say, it's a very interesting question, because the best space that I've ever shown in is the space that let me do what I wanted to do. And that could be anywhere, if it's a museum, or more often, one of these kind of little lost galleries or pop-ups, or someone's taken a space on, which is a derelict factory or whatever, and they say, can you come and do something? And they're on you with it. It's not like they've got an ongoing program. They say, oh, you've, like in a museum, oh, you've arrived, I'm sorry, I'm really busy, but just get on with it. And then they're in their next 6 months. But to go to somewhere and they say, and you say, well, listen, I know this could be difficult, but your floor, blah, blah, blah. And they say, that's absolutely okay. That is the best space to show in, because then you've got respect for the people inviting you. And they tend to follow you as well. They get intrigued by it all. But it's not that I do a lot of that tampering anymore. So,
brilliant.
Yeah. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you so much.